Hello again, ladies and gentlemen. Michael Matt coming into you from a rainy rooftop here in Tokyo, Japan. We're here this week to take part in a really very important traditional Catholic conference. And we're pretty excited to be here to meet this small but militant group of traditional Catholics here in Japan's capital. Some of these Japanese Catholics, by the way, would be direct descendants of the so-called hidden Catholics of Japan, Catholics who converted 500 years ago when St. Francis of Xavier and his missionaries first came here to Japan. After the great success, initial success, something like 300,000 converts, then a new shogunate comes in and clamps down on the whole island of Japan, cutting off all outside influences, especially the Catholic missionaries. So then the Catholics that are left, this remnant of Catholics who converted, they're left with a pretty dismal prospect then. For the next 250 years, they would withstand absolute brutal persecution. With no priests, no mass, no sacraments, they kept the faith for 250 years. So this period, by the way, was dramatized in the book and in the later film by Martin Scorsese, the film Silence. And whatever you think of that film or the take of on those missionaries in that story, the film does provide a fairly accurate depiction of the brutality that the Catholic missionaries and Catholics went through during this period. So the idea for us coming to Japan right now in the middle of what to me is beginning to look more and more like a preparation period leading up to another, you know, persecution, only this time a global persecution, a global crackdown on Christianity, it really appealed to me because I think we have something important to learn from these people who survived, who persevered in the faith, in the old faith, for such a long time without any sacraments, without the traditional Latin Mass at all. How can we, living in America, for example, how can we possibly, you know, give in to despair and, you know, running off to different religions and abandoning ship when you look at the example that was set for us here by the men and women of Japan who trusted in God so completely that they kept the faith for a quarter of a millennium. It's just a beautiful story, and especially since the Catholic, this isn't Europe, where, as Hilaire Belloc said, that the faith is Europe and Europe is the faith. It was never, the Catholic faith never really took deep root in Japan. So even though it never took root here in the larger population, the Catholics persevered, and it's a very important story for us right now. And here in Tokyo, you know, we've been walking around, I'm still kind of jet lagging, but we've been walking around, and you really can feel a difference in countries where Christianity never actually did take root. I mean, this is a huge, as you can see behind me, it's a huge, thriving metropolis. It's dominated by that famous Japanese work ethic, which seems to drive everything. The people here are very friendly, very hospitable, but there's also something missing. And in my opinion, what's missing is that this civilization, it was not built by Christendom. Christ never reigned here, truly. At least he was never proclaimed. His kingship was not proclaimed here by the majority of the people. And Japan, like the rest of the world right now, desperately needs Christ. So it's interesting to see sort of what happens to civilizations that never had Christ, now that we're facing the prospect of our own civilization expelling Christ to try to, you know, end up, we'll all be together in this sort of great big secular materialistic world. And I wonder if people understand what that really means. You know, there are problems, lots of problems here in Japan. There are the suicide gardens, the suicide forest, they call, which has become a very popular suicide destination. It's actually somebody's job, somebody's employment here in Japan to patrol these forests to bring the dead bodies back, the people who killed themselves, and to prepare them for burial. And because the suicide rate in Japan is so high, the government has actually enacted a plan of action that aims to reduce the rates of suicide by 20% within the next 7 years. So it's a huge problem. But with, you know, a population that is less than 40% now that identifies with any religion at all, I think they have 35% who are Buddhist, 3% Shinto sects, and fewer than 2% Christian, Japan has one of the highest suicide rates in the world. So partially, of course, because of the tradition, the different cultural, you know, consideration for suicide, but also because of exactly what St. Francis of Xavier argued Japan desperately needed 500 years ago. And that, of course, is the Lumen Christi, the light of Christ, Christianity. It needs Christ. As beautiful as this country is, as wonderful as the people are, obviously what's missing here is Christ. And that's, again, why we're here this weekend, to talk to the people who are trying to change all that by bringing Catholicism, the traditional Catholicism, back to Japan front and center. So I noticed, for example, there's no city center that has, you know, an old great Gothic cathedral that's dominating everything as you have in Europe, you know, reminding even secularized society now of what they once had, what they once were, and what they lost, and what they need to get back. That constant reminder of the cross isn't in these countries of the East, which were never Catholic. Now, I realize many people out there are going to say, well, you know, it's great since the Catholic Church is responsible for everything evil that ever happened in the world anyway. Japan is simply advanced beyond Christendom because they never got bogged down with Christ, you know, the Dark Ages. Forget about those centers of medieval learning at Chartres or at the Sorbonne in Paris or Oxford in England. Forget about all of that. Christendom only gave us one thing, the Dark Ages. And it wasn't until the Enlightenment came along that we developed this modern world and science. We got longer lives, true, we do. We live longer, but we've also developed the most advanced killing machines in human history. But they tell us, never mind all that. Just ignore the fact that those Catholic monks kept learning and history and knowledge alive in the so-called Dark Ages. In fact, wrote it all down so that we have it, so we have the history of the world, written on manuscripts, which are still extant today. You can check them out. Never mind all that. Never mind that the Catholic Church sponsored the greatest achievements, greatest architectural achievements, which the whole world still recognizes and acknowledges, and even weeps over, as they recently did when Notre Dame in Paris burned down. Never mind Michelangelo or Leonardo or Shakespeare or Copernicus, and yes, even Galileo, a Catholic who died in the good graces of the Church. Never mind these guys. Never mind the great advances in navigation and science and astronomy and philosophy and literature and the arts and music for which Christendom is solely responsible. Never mind. None of that matters. Why not? Because, oh, there were the Crusades. There were those evil Crusades. Because Christian soldiers went out 1,000 years ago to defend the Holy Land. That's a huge problem. That's the best these people can do when they want to bash the Catholic Church. The Crusaders, these guys who met on a battlefield and more or less acknowledged the rules of engagement, and maybe a few thousand people died in that honorable conflict. That's it. This they would compare to the millions slaughtered in modern times by Christless atheists such as Mao Zedong and Joseph Stalin and that Catholic-bashing Maximilian Kolbe-killing pagan nutjob Adolf Hitler, to say nothing of the most recent advancements in the killing machine, the abortion holocaust. We're just supposed to sit back and say, yeah, Christendom was really terrible, really ushered in the most evil in the Dark Ages in history. You know, because those Catholic kings, they called some crusades. So that's the end of that. People realize how stupid this sounds. About the Spanish Inquisition, that was bad, right? Yeah, do you realize that the Spanish Inquisition claimed far fewer lives than all those executed by Henry VIII and good old Queen Bess in England? You know some of their names, the names of these victims. They're still household names. Thomas More, Margaret Clitheroe, Edmund Campion, John Fisher, Oliver Plunkett, Margaret Ward, Robert Southwell, and on they go. We have paintings of these victims. We know what happened to them. But all we ever hear about is the Spanish Inquisition and how horrible Christendom was. I wonder, can anybody out there who's been drinking this Kool-Aid, can you actually name somebody who died under the Spanish Inquisition? I'm not saying nobody died under the Spanish Inquisition, but can you name any of the victims? Do they mean anything to you? I'm not defending it. I'm just asking the question. What does anyone actually know about all these Catholic bashing black legends? Nothing other than what they've seen in Steven Spielberg movies, right? Are there any stats, for example, on the millions upon millions of people who were exterminated by the Catholic kings and queens of Christendom? If there are, if you know where those stats are, please send us the stats on the genocide the Catholic Church is responsible for, and we'll show this. We'll do a show on this right here at Remnant TV. Because I just don't remember a whole lot about Catholic kings wiping out millions of people. I'm here in Tokyo this weekend to talk about the Vendée Uprising in Western France, where the paragons of Enlightenment liberty got things rolling by wiping out 500,000 of their own people, Catholics down in the Vendée. This was the first genocide in modern times, the first of many. So where is there even a claim of a Catholic country of Christendom doing such a thing to anyone, much less to its own citizens, as the Enlightenment fellows did in France? But people say, well, what about Mexico? Those evil Spanish conquistadors, they went down there looking for the gold, and they took people out. More importantly, they forced their religion on the peace-loving Aztec people.
The Aztec Great Temple was the place where official religion was put on display, as it was not possible to put on any place else in the whole empire.
The Aztecs believed in many gods, but chief among them was Huitzilopochtli, the god of sun and fire. To nourish and honor the deity, Aztec priests offered blood and human hearts. this ritual was performed so frequently that the steps of the Templo Mayor were permanently stained with blood.
Blood was sacred. Blood was the most precious thing that you had to give. And that's why it was so often given to the gods.
Sacrifice was necessary in the Aztec view in order to keep the sun rising every day, setting every evening, and coming up again the next day. In other words, it was necessary to sustain life here on Earth.
The Spanish conquistadors, led by Hernan Cortes, arrived in 1519. Their Christian sensibilities were offended by the ritual of human sacrifice. Even more appalling were stories of a festival of sacrifice that had taken place just 30 years earlier. In 1487, over a period of just 4 days, 20,000 men were said to have been brought to the city, laid across an altar, and relieved of their beating hearts.
The 1487 event is fascinating because it is the largest human sacrifice ever recorded in history.
The Spanish, by the way, did put an end to the human sacrifice, to the genocide of their time, but I guess it's racist of me to even point that out, right? Because the historical record clearly shows that the Spanish also educated their quote-unquote victims. They welcomed them into their church as equals. They ordained them as priests. They consecrated them as bishops of their church. They married them. They built a civilization with them that lasted for the next 500 years or so. You ever hear of Juan Diego? That indigenous person who was canonized a saint by the evil, racist Catholic Church? A brown-skinned indigenous guy that little Catholic kids hero worshiped for 500 years. Because as the church put it, Our Lady of Guadalupe had singled him out, appeared to him, and entrusted him with a message for the whole world. I'm sorry, where's the racism in all of this? The Catholic Church is the least racist institution in the history of the world. You can be any colored skin, you can speak any language, you can come from any country and rise to the very top of the Catholic Church leadership. So where is the racism? Anyway, these thoughts just come to mind when you come to a place like this, a beautiful city, a beautiful country. But as I say, the cross was never firmly planted here. So it makes you really appreciate what it actually means or should mean to all of us to be a Catholic, to be a part of the greatest civilizing force in the history of the world. And what the world needs now desperately, whether we're in Japan or Minnesota or Australia or wherever, what the world desperately needs is Christ, now more than ever. So in our rush to de-Catholicize Christendom, to de-Catholicize Europe and America, maybe we should look at some of these other countries where Christ never was and say, are we really so sure that's going to be an improvement? So again, we're here this weekend with a positive message. We're here in Tokyo because Christianity does have a thriving spark here, because Catholicism is making a move here. And we want to make a connection with these Christian people, with this remnant of this Catholic remnant of Japan, and to do whatever we can to defend and promote traditional Catholicism, even in countries like this where very few Catholics are here to begin with. I think there are something like 450,000 Catholics here, mostly in Tokyo, but also in Nagasaki and Osaka and Yokohama. But again, this burgeoning traditional movement to me is, it just should fill us all with hope. You know, and there are diocesan priests who are learning traditional Latin Mass. The priests of the Society of St. Pius X have a great foothold here in Japan, standing strong, witness to the powerful idea of Christ and the need to promote that idea throughout the whole world, to promote the very idea of Christ to a world, by the way, that has embraced another idea, an idea that is dark and dangerous. So in the face of the banner of this new world order that we're all facing, we need to raise another banner, and that is the banner of Christ the King, wherever we are. No matter what happens, we must remain committed to the idea of restoring the civilizing influence of Christ no matter where we live, no matter what they do to us for trying to make that happen. So stay tuned. That's the intention here from Tokyo this weekend. We're trying to bring the story of the people who have kept the faith here in Japan and who are working to not only keep it, but also to expand it and to make it stronger than ever. Stay tuned for Remnant TV's coverage of traditional Catholicism here in the land of the rising sun. We're also going to cover a big pro-life march right down here in the streets of Tokyo coming up on Monday, so stay tuned for that. Follow us on YouTube if you want to get all of this stuff. And don't forget to subscribe right now. Subscribe to the Remnant YouTube channel so that we can expand our reach, but also so that you'll be notified right away whenever we get something posted here on Remnant TV from Tokyo. Thanks very much for listening. Keep the faith, and we'll see you in a few days.